All right, this is Brennan Patrick and Hayden Dale recording our sealed gameplay for Channel Fireball. If you want to find the video where we open our packs and build our decks and go through some of the thought patterns that made us pick the classes that we did, you'll either be able to find that above or below or probably somewhere in the description. So with that, Hayden, you want to tell us, tell the viewers a little bit about the format we're going for, how I plan to be playing, and also just your seal pool in general.
Yeah, definitely. So as Brennan said, today we've got a Welcome to Wraith sealed deck battle that we're going to play out against each other. But rather than just go, and run a game, what we're going to do is, as we play, we're going to talk about the lines that we're taking, how we're trying to craft the game state, and how we're going to try and actually get the win over one another. So we're going to talk through each of the turns as we go. In terms of my sealed pool today, I've got a Bravo deck that's sort of been thrown out from that. I did also have a Warrior deck that was pretty close for me. I think it was probably just a couple of cards short, so I've opted to go for the Bravo build here. And in my video, I actually talked about sort of having 29 cards and another two cards that were kind of I thought I would play, and that was the Sigil of Solace Red, which I definitely want to play into Brennan's Katsu. Acts as a salve for his Kodachis, where I don't really ideally want to be blocking that one damage, but I can gain the life back. And the Red Slogism, I want to try and set up potentially an in-game state where I can dominate with the Bravo plus a big attack with Slogism. So that's my plan. What about you, Brennan? What have you got today?
Yeah, so I had a really interesting sealed pool, actually. I was very, very torn between Reinar and Katsu. It was the closest it's ever been for me for pretty much as long as I can remember. Actually, I had to kind of tank for a while in my sealed video, and just I was thinking about it. And I remember sweating, being like, oh, man, I got to finish this in a reasonable time, but I couldn't pick a class. So I ended up actually ending up on Katsu. But I think this is kind of one of those pools where I can try a few games with Katsu. If my game plans don't work or it's not feeling too well, I can always switch back to Reinar. I think both decks were strong. Kind of to see if what I built around is able to come to fruition in the late game.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things cool of Welcome to Wraith Sealed and Sealed in general in Flesh and Blood is you can often have two decks that are pretty close to one another in power level, and it's about how you're actually going to, craft that final 30 cards and be able to set up a game plan during those games to get the victory, which me and Brendan are going to try and do, get one over one another here. I'll take odd on the dice, Brendan.
Alrighty. So it is even. So this is actually a pretty interesting choice for Katsu. So, and against Bravo as well. So generally I like to go second and be, the first player to be taking cards out of the other player's hand. But against Bravo, I always threaten to let them go first because they can get off a big dominate attack that will crush. It can potentially affect my next turn quite significantly. I also think that Ninja can do a lot with less cards, unlike some other classes. So with that, I think I'm going to choose to go first here.
Cool. All right. Let's get into it.
All righty. All right. So we've drawn a pretty bad hand, to be honest. Drawn both attack reactions in our deck. We've drawn a Pummel and a Razor Reflex, and then we've drawn a Scar for Scar, which we're probably going to have to use to play the Kodachis. So I would like to filter this as much as possible. Unfortunately, since most of it is blue and yellow, I'm not going to be able to get much of it out of my hand. So with that, I'm probably going to opt to use the Razor to just get an extra point of damage in, just to get it out. So I'm going to start with a Kodachi for one.
Cool. So into the Kodachi attacks and with Brendan on starting here, I want to make sure that I can defend out the most amount of damage. So if Brendan has a really good hand where he can go, the Kodachi into maybe multiple attacks, I want to make sure I can block out those attack actions on the end of the chain. So pretty inclined here to take the first point of damage from Brendan. So I'll go to 19.
Yeah, and I'll respond to the no blocks and I will raise a reflex for plus one.
Yeah, okay. So I guess, is that a red, is it? Yep.
It's a blue, so okay. You get down to 18. So this is very low value for me. I would have liked to use this to get go again on an attack action later in the line. But I really do not have a choice considering the context of my hand.
Yep. And now that I know that Brendan's played out that Razor, I'm pretty inclined to block the second Kodachi and just get rid of some of the cards in my hand as well. My hand's a little bit awkward. It's not the worst hand. It would have been a great hand going first, actually, as I do have a Potion of Strength in it. But I'm just going to use a blue Stonewall Confidence to defend that.
Yeah, and with that, I will Arsenal pass. Unfortunately, I do have to keep the Pummel in my hand, and I will opt to put a defense reaction in Arsenal.
Yep. So we'll draw her up. Now, I have a pretty interesting hand. I do have three blues and an attack action and a yellow wounded bull. So my thought process is basically I want to play this wounded bull here. It's going to push some damage onto Brendan and make him either have to take damage or start pulling cards out of his hand, which is one of the things I like about going second, as Brendan said as well. What I could do is actually arsenal the potion of strength. And when Brendan has a solid turn where he wants to throw out quite a few attacks, I'm happy to just defend that out as much as possible and then play that potion of strength out for a later turn for setup towards the end of the game. So that's what I'm going to go for here. I think because I can also dominate this wounded bull to push damage, I'm pretty happy to do that. So I'm going to activate Briber's ability with this blue Raging Onslaught, pitch last its effort, and I'm going to come in for 7 with this wounded bull because I'm on less life here.
Yeah, so as the cards we play here, one thing we want to note is we see Hayden pitch Lastish Effort there. So that is a endgame scenario that we definitely do not want to face up against, or if we do, we want to be prepared for it. I don't think that we're going to have the tools in our deck to effectively deal with it, so I think we have to probably assume the role of the aggressor in this matchup if we're going to be successful. And again, I've drawn a very, very awkward hand, so I am going to have to play a low-value defense reaction. I'm going to block for 7 with a movable, but I'm going to pitch Pummel and open the center together.
Mm. Yep, okay. So that fully blocks out our attack. I'll ask on the last card and pass to you.
And this is one of the good things about Ninja, is that even though I do have one card in my hand, usually it can be the blue 0, let me get two damage in with the Kodachis if he decides to not block, but I also have these 0 costs that let me just go, you know, Fluster Fist for 4. Likely getting a card out of Hayden's hand here.
Yep. So unfortunately, with that last attack, I was actually hoping that because we dominated it, Brendan would have only defended with one card and tried to swing back for a bit of damage, and we could have potentially blocked out with a couple of cards from our hand, got that potion of strength into play and set up another arsenal card for a future turn, whether it be an attack to threaten or even a defense reaction. So as it stands, probably what I'm looking to do this turn is defend with one card and then just come in with another attack. I've got a yellow Barraging Brawnhide, which can threaten another 7 damage. So that's probably where I'll go. The other option is to just attack with the hammer. So we'll go ahead and we'll defend 3, take 1 there.
Okay.
So down to 17 for me.
Yep, and I will draw back up.
And so I think that's the play we're going to make. It threatens 1 more damage than the Anathos coming in with the Barraging Brawnhide here. So, and we can dominate it and try and make that same play again. So I'm going to pitch this yellow Cartilage Crush to Bravo, and then this blue immovable, and then come in for 6 or 7 if it's blocked with less than 2 cards to dominate.
6 or 7.
So really just trying to force Brennan to actually come back on his turn and swing a bit bigger. Try and put him into
we can block with the red flick out of arsenal, but all that's really going to gain us is getting an arsenal card next turn, or we can fully block this is really not that threatening from the Brava player compared to what we would expect to see. So while I don't want to use the red flick on this, I feel forced because I have drawn another defense reaction, another unmovable. I think I only have 3 in my deck, so they've been quite clustered so far.
Brennan just throwing a bit of shade there that this isn't very impressive, not very threatening.
Yeah, kind of, you know, a red disable, or, you know, I mean, what we're going to see in the late game, I'm sure, a last ditch effort is something that I would much rather use my flick on.
Yep.
But with that, I'm kind of just tanking a bit on how to block this. The only advantage being, oh man, I think we're just going to...
Yeah, the earlier for us we see defense reactions come out from the card 2 player, the better it is for us in terms of the late game, when we know we can start dominating cards and pushing through damage, or potentially lethal in the end game. So if any defense reactions come out here, we're definitely happy to see that.
Okay. This is probably the highest value play that gives us lines to work with on the next turn. We are going to block for 6 here.
Yep. So no +1 for the barraging. And over to you.
All right. So we're going to start off with a Surging Strike for 4 here.
Okay. So this looks like, you know, we know Brennan has one card left in hand, one resource left. If it's a zero cost card, that's probably our biggest concern. He can Katsu and go and find a Wyoming Gust Wave, but it would take us two cards to defend this out. Unless we did play this unmovable from our hand, which is not super exciting. So I think we're pretty happy to defend with two cards here. Probably take the one from Kodachi and then get our potion strength out if we can. So I think that's what we're going to go ahead and do. We'll go ahead here and defend with a Scar for a Scar and a Buckling Blow for five.
Yeah, so as a Katsu player, obviously we would have loved to grab our Whelming Gust Wave if he had decided to take one damage from it. With that, with him blocking two cards, I think we're still happy to arsenal this card. We're going to come in with a Kodachi for one for our last resource.
Yep. And so we could throw a card here to defend it. I would actually prefer to take the one damage than lose one of these blues out of my hand that block for three and pitch for three and cost three, so it does turn on Anathos. So happy just to go to 16 here.
Mm. And we are still threatening on this side. We are still threatening like a red Wounded Blow or red Fluster Fist or something like that.
Exactly.
On that line. Over to you.
Yep. So my turn. We're just going to get out the Potion of Strength now and set this defense reaction, this red unmovable into Arsenal, and then chip it back to Brennan.
Sounds good. On our turn, it's a consideration to play out this Nimblism, but also to keep it in hand. It's one of those turns where I would love to have Heart and Cross Traps, but of course we do not.
Brennan complaining there despite the fact he's got a full suite of equipment, which Brennan, mind you, always has. So
somehow I tend to open just all the good stuff when it comes to equipment, but still lose the game, you know? The classic. Whew. How are we going to do this? Yeah, unfortunately, we're drawing a lot of four-card hands we're not really able to efficiently use. All of these cards. Fortunately, we have to leave this face up here. Tough. I guess this is going to be probably the best thing we can do against our opponent is the redhead jab vanilla for three.
So now we have to consider, if we let this hit, Brennan can go and find the open center, potentially attack us for five or six with Dominate. If we defend this, though, and Brennan has that card anyway, that could be a bit scary for us. I think because he's leading with it, it would say to me that maybe he doesn't have it. He'd probably try and get him with the Kodachis first otherwise, unless he doesn't have a card. He could pitch well to Kodachi with maybe no zero-cost blues. On our turn, we have a pretty good play where we can keep a blue and a Blessing of Deliverance, red Blessing, draw a card, and then start to gain some life back that these Kodachis have inflicted on us. Plus, we have this defense reaction to always fall back on if we need to. So I think we'll go ahead here and block with the red Disable for three.
Yeah, this is tough for us because we're likely one resource short of actually doing what we want to here. I guess, let me think about what else we can grab.
So unfortunately for us, we only have one blue in our hand, which makes Brennan's next play a little bit scary for us. If we had two blues, we could, you know, confidently play the unmovable if we needed to, plus Blessing on our turn, whereas it stands. So it's a little bit worrying about what he could have.
Yeah, so we're going to respond and raise it for plus one.
Yep. So we'll take the one, get a 15. Yep.
We will use Katsu's ability. We'll discard Red Nimblism. There's the deck. If we had the resources, we'd love to grab Open the Center here. We just don't. There's no real way to kind of utilize our resources there very well. So we're going to have to grab the Red Blackout pick. The thing to notice as we shuffle our deck, we have reset our pitch order. So the only information we're going to have is going to be that yellow sink blow on the bottom. And that's going to be a blackout kick for four.
Okay. So a bit of a decision for us here. Ideally, the most efficient defense here would be just to throw this Sloggism for two, take two, and then Blessing and Deliverance on our turn. But this Sloggism could be really key to setting up an end game. And as much as I don't want to take four damage here, it's definitely a consideration. I think because Brennan probably feels that he needs to be pretty aggressive in this matchup, I actually want to defend damage as much as possible. And we can get by without the Sloggism. We have enough sort of other red attacks and things we can Bravo late game. So go ahead and defend for two and take two here off the blackout kick.
Cool. Down to 13. That's the Cosmic player as we see Sloggism defended with. We do need to kind of keep in mind regurgitating Sloggism in the end game. Obviously, Bravo can dominate most of his attacks anyway, but it is always an option for a low resource dominant.
Slog. So we're going to pitch the Raging Onslaught to play Blessing of Deliverance. That's going to help us gain some life next turn, hopefully. So we'll draw a card off that since this costs three. And one resource left. So we're actually going to... The card we drew was a Yellow Palmer, which we're then going to pitch so that we can come in with Anaphos. Fortunately, it's only for four because we don't have two cards that cost three or greater in the pitch zone, but it's damage presenting nonetheless. So we'll come in with Anaphos.
Yeah, so this is a bit weird for us. We have a consideration to play the Sync Blow in our arsenal and get rid of one of these Open the Centers. We have a few lines next turn. We can try to hit with the Surging Strike. We can even dominate it at that. Or sorry, not dominate, but Goliath Gauntlet. Try to get it over, but really it's face-up damage, and he knows I'm probably going to go grab, you know, whatever after. So with these resources, it's the Yellow Sync from Arsenal or block with this Open the Center. Or we just block with just the Sync Blow, and we don't filter, and we play Blue Head Jab into Yellow Open the Center with Dominate. And then we Arsenal the Surging Strike, which... I think we're going to go with that. We're just going to Sync Blow from Arsenal here.
Mm-hmm. Cool. No effect?
We'll take one. No effect.
So 19 plays. Oop. 19 plays
13. We know where that Palmer is at stack right now.
Exactly.
It's right next to the Raging Oscillate. So watch it. If we see him pitch another red down there to, you know, be with that, it's something to keep track of. It's also pretty close to the LBE.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and a consideration for us is we've just pitched that pummel, so to remember that as we go through the game, that we're going to come back to that, and that could be a possible win condition for us. Cool, over to you.
Cool. We're going to start with a head jab for one.
So this is an interesting one. This is one where, again, the open the center is being threatened. This could be time that we actually look to our equipment to defend. We don't lose a card from hand if Brennan does happen to have to open the center, but we don't let him just go and find it and start to chain together potentially quite a strong turn. So I think that's what we'll do here. We'll go ahead and use the Helm of Ice's Peak to defend for one.
Okay. Defending for one. Actually, looking over this attack, there is a reconsideration to actually pitch the head jab and then play Surging Strike into open the center. But I really want to get the Surging Strike in my arsenal. That's what's making it tough for me. So I'm going to play Open the Center for five with Go again.
This is a good opportunity for us to use our unmovable red that we have in Arsenal. So we do have three other blue cards in hand that we can use. So just go ahead. We want to keep the cards that do cost three or greater, potentially attacking with Anathos next turn. So we'll pitch Demolition Crew blue and play unmovable red for eight.
Sounds good. We will Arsenal Bass.
So we get away with, I guess, not taking any damage on that turn, which is good for us. And we counter on the helm there. Okay. So Blessing's going to activate at the start of our turn. Reveal the top three cards. We've got a yellow Onslaught, blue Winter Bull, and red Sigil. So not the end of the world. We're going to gain two life there. We're going to go to 15, so we are clawing back some of that lead that Brennan has, and then we know what we've got on top. Unfortunately, Brennan also knows what we've got on top, so he can sort of craft his turn around what he thinks that we'll potentially do next turn. In terms of our attack, so as I said, we've got the two blues. We can just pitch to Bravo with the first blue and then come with Anathos so that we can make sure we come with a six here.
Mm-hmm.
So one resource left. So yeah, the first blue pitching to the Bravo so that we can then pitch the second blue to get our Anathos up to six attack here. And that leaves us with our red defense reaction, our removable to place into Arsenal.
We have an aggressive line on our turn if we decide to not Arsenal. Fortunately, I feel like we need to be more of an aggressor at this point. It makes me want to block for two with this Snatch. Snatch, obviously a very good card in our deck, but I can't see myself utilizing Snapdragon Scalar Store later in the game. Now knowing that he has a sigil on top of that Blessing Deliverance life gain, I don't think that any kind of life advantage we get by using Snapdragon Scalar is going to be too significant. So I would rather use it to actually kill. So I'm going to block for two and take four.
Yep, okay. So down to 15 for Brennan. So 15 plays 15. And we'll Arsenal last card and pass it over to you. So we're going to, just in terms of our pitch order, we're going to put this this Cranial Crush first for the potential pummel plays off a five-card hand.
Sure. We're going to start with a Scour of the Battlescape and Kodachi for one.
Fine to take that one. So down to 14.
And we're gonna Kodachi for two.
For one. Brennan's so used to playing Ira at this point that every Kodachi on the second attack is for two now. again, we have a pretty hand that we can play pretty well on our turn. So we have blue Wounded Bull and the yellow Raging Onslaught that we saw, but we also have drawn a red Raging Onslaught. So we have a play of potentially just coming back with that red Raging Onslaught. Or just coming in with Hammer. At this point, keeping two cards and coming in with our Hammer and setting up for late game and not burning too many cards. If we keep pitching to attack every time, fatigue could become an issue for us. And so far, we haven't seen a drone out of Brendan. So there is potential that we could even fatigue him potentially. So we'll go to 13 here. We'll take the one and just look to block the next attack that he comes up with attack action.
Cool. We will Surging Strike for five.
Yeah, so that can be a bit scary, but this is probably a pretty good opportunity for us to play out the Immovable here, not let him go and search up that Whelming Gust Wave. If he does have it, we would need to probably throw our next two cards to make sure that Bren doesn't draw a card and get a lot of value off of it. But if he has it, he has it. So we'll pitch the blue Wounded Bull and we'll defend with red Immovable here.
Cool. And then we'll follow up with it over this open the center red for five. No dominate.
So a bit of a decision for us. We can either hold on to these red and blue Raging Onslaught to come in for six, or we can just throw one or two to defend here. So we could block with the yellow, Arsenal the red, and just play Sigil of Solace, set up for the following turn. One thing to note is Brennan has used his whole hand here, so he doesn't have an Arsenal to come back at us with a really scary five-card hand next turn. So I'm probably okay to defend for three, soak up a bit of damage and then set up my own Arsenal to come back at him. So, yep, we'll defend for three and take two down to 11 here.
All right, and I will drop and pass to you.
Cool. So, just going to play Sigil to gain three up to 14 and Arsenal this Onslaught and pass.
At this point, I'm quite worried and thinking that I'm going to have to utilize the Kodachis to not fatigue out to this Bravo deck. Our graveyard, so many Surging Strikes we've used. We do have three total, two yellow, one red. So we still have a Surging Strike in the deck. Should be relatively close. Oof. That is a tough one. Maybe push a bit of damage here. Arsenal the Surging, Arsenal the Whelming, and then hope to draw that yellow Surging sooner rather than later. Or we can Arsenal the Razor. Line here.
So of note, we have 12 cards left in our deck now. So we are starting to think about fatigue and what could happen depending on how Brendan starts to attack us here.
Like, we don't have a really good way to utilize this hand. Even if we do the arsenal, it seems like we ending up with two cards at the end of it, which is not ideal. There's 15, so a Scarfer's card doesn't have go again, even though it's blue. Fun for us.
So the consideration for our turn is we have two blues and two reds. So ideally, I'd like to get a red to the bottom that we can set up with the pummel late game, and just to have to set up late game. I've blocked with quite a few reds so far, so just need to think about that on our turn as well. So coming in for one here?
Yep, coming in for one.
Yep, so happy to take that down to 13.
Coming in for two.
I think because now where we're at, the life totals are pretty close, and we've managed this game okay through the early stages, not taking too much damage. I now want to try and push some damage onto Brendan, especially while we have good red cards in our hands. So we are probably going to have to block, but not on the Skadachi. We'll go to 12.
And when no blocks are, when the opponent says no blocks, there is a consideration for us to just raise for this. It's a low value raiser though, which is hard. I think we're just going to put the razor in the deck and play up in the center.
Okay, so take the one, just the one down to 12 from that Kadachi. So that's open center four.
That's for three.
For three. So we definitely want to prevent some of this, but we want to make sure we can keep cards in our hand for next turn. I'd love to make Brendan start to use his equipment on defense if he could. So, but again, I would really like to get a red down to the bottom here. So I think what we'll do is we will defend with one of our blue cards here, and then just come in with a stability data on our turn. So we'll go ahead here and defend with Crush Confidence for three, block that out.
We will arsenal.
Cool. And so, as I said, we'll pitch a blue and a red Raging Brawnhide to play debilitate, just coming in for eight.
Oh, and getting the red to the bottom of the deck. That's no joke right there.
Exactly. And the reason we decided to come with the debilitate rather than the red Raging Onslaught and Arsenal, most part is we have the resources to play this for four now, whereas we might not have we might be left with one card in a future turn, and it'd be great if we could just come in with seven, because one blue card only lets Anathos come in for four. So it's just more damage output that we can keep presenting into Brendan here.
You're making my life so hard, Hayden.
We just want to crush.
Oh my gosh. So let me think about this. We have minus two is not fun, that's for sure.
Yeah, in theory, the debilitate is just going to take away Brendan's first Kadachi effectively, make it worth nothing. But if Brendan has a hammer he needs to attack with an attack action, say something like a head jab or a surging strike or a leg tap first, that's going to be massive for us to get this crush effect off.
Yeah, or if Brendan has a hand that doesn't have the resources to pay for a single Kadachi, he wants to execute his plan. Woo! I think we have to take both. They're just all of it. Oh. It's brutal. So do you have 15 to 12 here?
Yeah, 15 to 12, exactly.
Glad I do not take eight. Oh, okay. How are we going to get out of this game? All right. We're taking eight.
Okay. So got it. Dropping to seven. And crush effect of negative two on the first attack is active. So over to you.
So never somewhere you want to be, but I just really do not see a line outside of that. We're going to, let me consider this actually. This is a weird scenario. I can't play that. So many things I want to do that I can't. Darn. bottom of my deck is not looking fantastic either. We're going to Kadashi for one here.
Yep. And Brendan, how many cards have you got left in your deck there? That's now a consideration for us around where we can get to. We are ahead on life. If we can manage the life total and keep using a hammer, we can potentially fatigue here.
10 cards in deck.
9 cards. Okay. So we're pretty even on cards. So we'll take the first one down to 11.
Yep, down to 11. We're going to swing again. I'm very concerned about his humble that's coming, so...
Oof. So we want to focus on the attack actions rather than the Kadachis here with our life lead. So down to 10.
Surging Strike for 4.
4. So this is probably a great spot for us to start using our equipment to just utilize one card plus defend that out. So I think that's what we'll probably do here, just considering the options. Because Brennan still has... Any resources left, Brennan?
No resources left.
Resources, one card in hand. So if it's a zero cost attack, I mean, we definitely don't want to let him go and get one gust wave. So we'll keep the blues in hand. We'll use this yellow stone with confidence plus our iron rot legs to defend for 4 here. We do know that Brandon has a razor, but it can't be played on surging. Yeah.
We're in a whelming for 7 here.
That's a big whelming. So for us here, definitely want to stop this, which we can. So we have three blue cards in hand. One of them unfortunately blocks 2, but we could use that to come back with our hammer or the red attack action. So this is going to chew our last piece of equipment, but it's going to stop Brendan from drawing a card and getting a lot of value out of this. So we'll go ahead and defend for 7 there.
Yeah, we're quite happy to see the LDE go, but still very concerned with how the bottom of my deck is ordered in this matchup.
So on our turn, we could come in with a red Rage Onslaught. At this point, I would like to keep that to set up a big dominate turn. We're enough ahead on life at 10 to 7 that's possible. So I think what we're going to do here is pitch this blue Nimble Strike and just come in with 4 for Anathos. Just keep some pressure on Brendan.
Oof. Pressure you have, that is for sure. Ugh. How many cards?
10 cards left in deck.
13?
10, sorry, 10.
I was going to say, we are losing. Yeah, we're just going to have to block for 3.
Yep, so take 1 down to 6. So 6 plays 10.
Yep, to think about my utilization of these scalers and Goliath going with the rest of my deck since I know entire content. Wish we could.
Yeah, Brendan is a little bit tougher than us on the decisions he needs to make here. So it's a yellow Rising Nethros?
Yep.
Just for 2. So we know that Brennan can scale that. We have seen one blackout kick, but very, very possible that Brennan could have a second one. In which case, if he scales this and is able to go find one, that's for a huge amount of damage. So a bit of a decision to make here. He could also just have the card in his hand as well. We haven't seen it pitched, I don't believe, so... Very likely that he just has it here. So we want to utilize our life total pretty well here. I think we're okay to take that and let him play it out. Defend some of that. Blackout kick doesn't have go again anyway. So we can just make sure we stand enough life total, keep the advantage, and we have a pretty good hand to come back with multiple blues in our attack actions. We can dominate here. So yeah, Brendan, we'll take the 2 down to 8.
Yeah, so this play... Face up, it's terrible, right? But we know, like, the bottom of my deck is real bad. It's real bad. So, but it does go Razor Reflex, Nimblism. So right now, like, I need to get a target down there for that Razor Reflex. I don't know if we're going to get there at this point. But, yeah, we're going to Blackout Kick for 6. And then we're going to pitch the Wounding Blow. We're just going to try to get that down near our Razor Reflex and apply pressure to Hayden. In one of these final turns. We also still have Goliath Calling. I believe we still have one open the center in the deck. May have a head jab, but I'm not sure about that. I thought I had 2 yellows. But yeah, coming up for 6.
So no cards, no resources left, right?
Nope, nothing.
So bit of a decision for us here. We know that Brendan's not going to have a defense reaction in Arsenal, and we do have Pummel plus our Potion of Strength plus our red attack. So we can actually get an attack for 12 here with Brendan at 6, which even with this 2 equipment is potentially enough to be lethal here. So I think it's worth the risk of us going to 2 to do so and then come back. So that's what we're going to do. Try and go for the throw here. We'll go down to 2.
Yep. And I think that is the right play. 100%.
Yep, so pretty straightforward on our turn.
Yeah, so we knew that pummel was coming. So we had to apply as much pressure as possible.
Yep, so bravo. Activate the Potion of Strength. One resource left here. And then we're coming in for 9 with Dominate. Off the Raging Onslaught.
9 plus 3. Oh, man. Can we... So... We discarding.
So the color that Brennan would need here really would be an immovable, so which we have seen pitched. But at the same time, we're going to force him out of cards.
So that's going to be for 7.
Yep. So we'll pummel over the top.
Let's consider this discard here. Ooh, very rough, because the last target for our Goliath Gauntlet is actually in our hand. Which is hard. Drone of Brutality would be nice. Man, let's think about this. How many cards do we have in deck? We have 5 cards in deck. 1 going to the bottom after this turn.
I'm at 7.
Yeah, I'm at 5. So I'm losing on that end too. Woo!
So now our consideration once Brendan gets his turn back is we're just going to survive through the Kadachis and get off another attack. Brendan's going to be at 1 here, so every attack's going to be forcing lethal.
Suck. I just don't think we're going to have the resources to... So we're going to... need a lot. Yeah, I just don't think we're going to be... So we pitched... I pitched a pummel. Pummel this card. Later down the line. Right, with Goliath Gauntlet. I just don't think we're going to have the resources to do it because he's going to swing for 4 and I'm going to block with 2 cards. I had to block with both armor here to even go to 1.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think we're going to have to discard that.
Yep. So, and it's Brendan to 1. So, 1 plays 2. Back to Brendan. So, we're going to put this, in terms of our pitch order, we're going to put some movable on the bottom. We now don't really want to see that when we're playing into Kadachis, so keep that last.
Yeah, so we have an option here. We have a yellow sink blow. So we can Kadachi for lethal, right? Which is going to take 1 card, only 1 card. We can still definitely die on the backswing. If we arsenal it, it's likely he won't be able to dominate, attack, and kill us. Still, there's is there that red Bronze Bronhide down there? If there is, then I think we die. Either way. So I think we're going to Arsenal and Sega.
Yep. So we haven't drawn the red. I believe that's going to be the next card for us. But what we do have is we have this blue Cranial Crush that we pitched earlier, and we do have the 3 blues that we'd pitched. So as we said earlier, you know, potential to set that up. So we're going to go ahead, bravo, and then come in for 8 with Dominate.
8 for us is going to be unbeatable, unfortunately. So we're going to end with Scar for a Scar, and there's our Pummel and our Razor. With him putting the immovable on the bottom, it's decently likely that we're able, if we don't die this turn, which we do, that we're able to Razor the first Kadachi when he opts not to block it. He won't, at 2 life. With that said, we could have kind of seen this coming. This pitch was face up, the Cranial. To be honest, kind of forgot about it, but say this was the Wounded Bull or the Blue Put Crush Confidence, we'd be in a very different situation here, right? Because we have the Sink Blow in Arsenal. And then we would have been able to raise that first Kadachi and potentially win. Obviously, we're winning on more of a kind of a cheap way. We're cheesing it. But, man, we got in a really bad situation there towards the end. And with, you know, with kind of having to discard our last card and only living by 1.
Yep.
And that's rough against Bravo.
Yeah. So really, really illustrating the power of sitting at the bottom of the deck and how much pitch order does matter, not only in this game in Flesh and Blood, but also in the Seal format because of how readily you are going to move through that deck. So obviously both me and Brennan were trying to set up the bottom of our deck, but for Brennan, it was a little bit more awkward. He had to go and find that blackout kick early, which messed up his pitch order as well. So yeah, look, that's how it goes in this game. Me and Brennan are going to be looking to do a few more of these videos in the future. If you've got any suggestions for which games you'd like to see played, if we're playing Blitz or Classic Constructed, then let us know. If you'd love to see more Sealed or Limited with Welcome to Wraith or Monarch when it comes out, let us know. That's all for me. What about you, Brennan? Anything to say before we head off?
Yeah, I would love to hear your feedback. I'd also love to hear your thoughts on the format in general. Welcome to Wraith. What classes do you think maybe shine more than others? Are there any that you think are unplayable? I know it's kind of funny that I actually ended up playing Ninja, I think, because I remember when Welcome to Wraith was, it was just Welcome to Wraith. So Welcome to Wraith Alpha season. Back when we would play the Limited Callings, I and a lot of the people that I played with actually considered Ninja to be so weak that it was almost unplayable sealed. I think that this is very, very wrong. I think it's one of the easier classes to force alongside Brute. Obviously, Guardian has that consistency, just looking for the blues. But I think that Ninjas can be extremely strong. But yeah, I would love to hear your thoughts and kind of what you think. The format, what kind of determines the format, what are the best classes and what are the best strategies. And I hope that, what we did helped illustrate some of the more advanced tactics with setting up the bottom of the deck and kind of, always playing your games to win, right? I know it sounds really simple, but I feel like a lot of people can get caught up in just playing out their hands and pushing as much damage as possible. Where you saw Hayden do multiple times is where he would set up the bottom of the deck with that pummel or that red barraging, and even that Cranial Crush that eventually won him the game. And I think that, it's a core concept to kind of work on and to get better as you play the game more.
100%. All right. Well, until next time, that's it for me and Brennan. Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye.